Hey everybody, and welcome back. Today we're going to be talking about the brachial plexus, which is the innervation of the upper limb. This is a topic that shows up a lot on standardized exams for any kind of health professional, medical school, DO school, chiropractic, etc., etc., and is something that we see a lot of in clinical application because people have upper limb injuries pretty frequently. So let's get started on diagramming the brachial plexus. The nerves of the brachial plexus come from the anterior rami of the cervical C5, C6, C7, C8, and the first thoracic anterior ramus, T1. Now each of these send a little branch outward. It's going to be referred to as the root of the brachial plexus. So we have, for example, the C5 root, C6 root, etc. What's going to happen is that the C5 and C6 roots combine to form the superior trunk. C7 just continues onward. Its root just continues as the middle trunk. And then C8 and T1 combine to form the inferior trunk. All right. Now at this point, each trunk, superior, middle, and inferior, gives off a branch or a division that goes anteriorly, which would be out from the paper, and one branch that goes posteriorly, a division that goes away from the surface of the paper here. We'll start with the anterior division of the superior trunk and the middle trunk, because both of these come together to form the lateral cord. So roots form trunks, trunks divide and form cords. The anterior division of the inferior trunk travels on its own and becomes, if there's a lateral cord, there's going to be somewhere around there, a medial cord. And then, I said each of these gives off a posterior division. The posterior division of the superior trunk fuses with the posterior division of the middle trunk and the posterior division of the inferior trunk. So this composite structure right here travels and is known as the posterior cord. And a quick note on these cords, they're named for their relationship to the axillary artery. The axillary artery is a big vessel that feeds the upper limb, and the lateral cord is on its lateral side, medial on the medial side, posterior on the posterior side, hence the name. Now we'll get to where the real meat of this presentation is. The cords divide to form the terminal branches of the brachial plexus. And the lateral cord gives off the first of our big five, and that is the musculocutaneous nerve. And it's going to be getting its innervations from the C5 to C7 roots. Now, there's some disagreement in different sources about this. I'm pulling this information from each level on what each nerve carries from clinical-oriented anatomy, my Moore, Daly, and Agour. Likewise, the medial cord gives off another big one, the ulnar nerve, and that's coming from the C8 to T1 levels. And then both the lateral cord and the medial cord send one of their branches here out to fuse and form the median nerve. And he's getting contributions from C6 to T1. Now the posterior cord also splits and gives off one branch that's very proximal. That's going to be the axillary nerve right there. And it's getting its contributions from C5 to C6. And then its other division, which other branch I should say, is the radial nerve. And it's getting contributions from everybody, from C5 all the way down to T1. Now this is pretty much what 90% of the questions on the brachial plexus will cover, the big five terminal branches. We're going to fill in some of the other more proximal branches as well. The lateral cord gives off a lateral pectoral nerve. And, surprise, surprise, the medial cord gives off a medial pectoral nerve. Now, the medial cord also gives off two sensory branches to the arm and the forearm, and, thankfully for common sense, they are called the medial cutaneous nerve of the arm, or the medial brachial cutaneous, if you're a fan of the Latin, and for the forearm, the medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm. And Latin again, that'd be the medial interbrachial cutaneous. Now, the posterior cord has three important branches. First one is referred to as the upper subscapular. And if there's an upper, somewhere around here there's got to be a lower subscapular nerve. In between these two, we commonly see another branch. This is going to be the thoracodorsal nerve. And that's it for the cords. Now, coming back up here to the trunks, it's all about the superior trunk and its parent branches. C5 gives off what's called the dorsal scapular nerve, and then the superior trunk itself is going to give off two branches. One's very important. That's the suprascapular nerve, and another one that is of kind of paltry significance to most, that's the nerve to the subclavius muscle. All right, now one last branch or terminal nerve that we care about is actually coming off very proximally, and it's coming off of the roots. And it's getting its input from C5, C6, and C7. And that is the long thoracic nerve. Okay. Those are the branches of the brachial plexus. Now, there are several videos that you can look at that give you a quicker, easier way to draw these out, remember which ones are where. I like doing it this way from start to finish because it gives you a sense of the flow of information from proximal to distal. But do whatever works for you. Let's draw in some of the contributions to each one of these terminal nerves first, and then we'll talk about what their functions are. To start with, musculocutaneous nerve is getting input from C5 to C7. So from the C5 root, fibers jump onto the superior trunk, onto its anterior division to join the lateral cord, and then onto musculocutaneous. And paralleling that pretty much exactly, from C6 root, superior trunk, anterior division, lateral cord, all the way up to musculocutaneous. Finally, C7 has some contribution to the musculocutaneous nerve as well. That's going to be going on the middle trunk, jumps onto its anterior division to wind up with the rest of its buddies here in the lateral cord. All right. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the function of the musculocutaneous nerve as it innervates the muscles of the anterior arm. All right, now the musculocutaneous nerve innervates the muscles of the anterior compartment of the arm. And on the illustration here, we've got the coracobrachialis coming from the coracoid process of the scapula to the arm, the humerus. The biceps brachii has two heads from the coracoid process, the short head, and the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula to the long head. And they both insert onto the forearm with an apinerosis going to the fascia of the forearm here, and also a nice strong tendon going to the radial tuberosity. So biceps brachii is a strong flexor of the arm, of the forearm at the elbow. The more important flexor, however, is this muscle that's deep to it, also innervated by musculocutaneous, and that is the brachialis. So both of these muscles, biceps brachii and brachialis, flex the arm at the elbow. And the biceps brachii is also a strong pronator of the arm when it's already flexed at the elbow. Now, one quick fun note. this muscle right here on the extensor side, the brachioradialis, sometimes is dually innervated by the musculocutaneous and radial. Usually we just call it radial, but just be aware, musculocutaneous may sneak in there. Sensory musculocutaneous innervates the skin of the lateral forearm. So if I'm standing in an anatomical position here, lateral forearm is right here. So anytime you've got weakness in the anterior compartment, loss of sensation here, that's screaming musculocutaneous. How you test that is by having someone flex their arms, their elbows rather, against resistance and seeing if one side is weaker than the other. So just FYI, here's 15 pound weight, and I could lift more, although it's obvious I'm not a bodybuilder, but for ease I just wanted to show this smooth motion curling up is using the biceps brachii and the brachialis muscle. Inability to do this or dissymmetry on either side, asymmetry is going to give you a clue in that one side may have a musculocutaneous lesion. All right, now that we finished with the musculocutaneous nerve, let's talk median nerve. The median nerve is going to need its contributions from C6 to T1. C6 is coming from the lateral cord, just as it got there before, jumps onto this branch that's going to the the median nerve. Same way, getting contributions from C7, the wind up in the median nerve. Then C8 and T1 get there from the C8 root, joining the inferior trunk, jumping onto its anterior division, into the medial cord, up to its contribution to the median right there to join, and likewise T1 root, inferior trunk, anterior division, medial cord, and then the branch of that cord that goes to the median nerve takes it out here with the rest. So that's how the median nerve gets its innervation, and now we'll take a moment to talk about its function. Now the median nerve, as mentioned before, shares with the ulnar nerve the job of innervating the flexors of the forearm and the hand. The median nerve gets its name from the fact it's going to travel down the midline of the arm and then the midline of the forearm on the way to the hand. Now in the forearm, it innervates the flexors that are not innervated by the ulnar nerve. So it's going to be innervating the flexor carpi radialis, which is going to flex and radially deviate the wrist. It's going to innervate the palmaris longus, which is this nice long strapping muscle that spreads out into the palmar aponeurosis. It's a weak flexor of the wrist. It's going to innervate the superficial digital flexor. It's the muscle that helps bring the fingers together but doesn't strongly fold the distal interphalangeal joint. So it's going to help fold the digits but not all the way up to the end. And it's going to innervate the pronator teres, which goes from the medial epicondyle, like all of these flexors of the forearm, to the radius, and it's going to pronate the forearm and the hand, like so. So supination turns to pronation, like that. Now at that point, the median nerve continues down to the hand, but it gives off a deep branch here in the forearm called the anterior interosseous nerve, and it's going to innervate some of the deeper muscles in that region. First off, the deep digital flexor is partially innervated by the ulnar, but the other half, going to the second and the third digits, is innervated by the anterior interosseous. So flexing those distal interphalangeal joints strongly is going to be done by the radial side of the deep digital flexor. It's going to innervate the flexor pollicis longus. That's going to flex the interphalangeal joint of the thumb strongly. It's going to innervate the pronator quadratus, which is located very deep right here between the radius and the ulna, actually kind of where my cuff is. And it's going to be a muscle that helps pronate the wrist and the hand. All right, now at that point, we move into the hand itself. And the median nerve gives off some branches to two little muscles here. The first lumbricule goes to the second digit, and the second lumbricule goes to the third digit. Now these guys have been described a couple different ways. One thing that's listed that they do is they help flex the MCP, the metacarpal phalangeal joint. But their more important job is to actually strongly extend the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints. So the lumbricals are needed to really stretch those fingers. Now on its way to the lumbricals, The median nerve gives off a little branch that loops back to the pad of the thumb, which we'll refer to as the thenar eminence. This recurrent branch in the median innervates these muscles. And when it gets damaged, the thumb becomes weak and somewhat clumsy because it can't finally control movement of the thumb. The muscles that are innervated by that recurrent branch are the abductor pollicis brevis, the flexor pollicis brevis, and the opponens pollicis. So abducting, flexing, and opposition, bringing it across the hand, are going to be affected by denervation of the recurrent branch of the median nerve. Now, one place that the median nerve typically gets compromised is at the carpal tunnel, and that's what is covered by this flexor retinaculum shown right here in the illustration. Carpal tunnel is where all the tendons of the deep and superficial digital flexors and the flexor pollicis longus travel through, in addition to the median nerve. Because it's a very tight, confined space, inflammation of those tendons will compress the median nerve and cause motor loss or motor weakness to the pad of the thumb. But the first thing that people will complain about is typically sensory problems associated with the median nerve. And the median nerve is sensory to the palm of the hand that's not covered by the ulnar. So the palmar side of the first, second, third, and half of the fourth digit, the radial half of the fourth digit, are what's innervated sensory by the median nerve. So tingling or loss of sensation in that area is associated with median nerve signs. Weakness of these muscles can also be caused by compression at the carpal tunnel. But the median nerve can also get compressed as it crosses through the pronator teres. The pronator teres actually has two bellies, and the median nerve goes through them and can become compressed by traction or spasm of that muscle. In that case, you're going to have carpal tunnel signs, but likely also involvement of the anterior interosseous nerve. And the easiest way to check for that is to ask someone to make an O with their thumb and their index finger, their first and second digits. If they can maintain that O, pinch the fingers together, then the deep muscles of the anterior forearm are okay. But if that flexor pollicis longus and that flexor digitorum to the second digit are weak, they won't be able to maintain the O, it'll collapse. So that's one way to check for that. All right, that's the median nerve. We'll move on.
We covered the median nerve and the musculocutaneous. Now let's jump down to the ulnar. Ulnar is going to be a nice little corollary to the median nerve, and it's getting its innervation by the C8 and T1 contributions to the medial cord here, and they just jump on to the ulnar nerve, or more precisely, they are the medial cord's contributions to the ulnar nerve. So C8 and T1 right there. And we'll journey back to the forearm and the hand to talk a little bit about the ulnar nerve.
And the ulnar nerve travels down the arm and passes posterior to the medial epicondyle, the humerus, to get it to the forearm. So that's right here, and you might be familiar with this as your funny bone. So if you want to feel the sensory watershed of the ulnar nerve, all you need to do is jam your fingers in here real hard, and you'll feel a nice shooting or kind of stabbing electrical pain in that region, which is the fifth digit on both the palmar and the dorsal side, and the radial aspect of the fourth digit. So this region, both on the palmar and dorsal side, is where the ulnar nerve's superficial branch innervates the skin. In terms of motor activity, once it gets to the forearm, the ulnar nerve is very easy. It innervates the flexor carpi ulnaris and the deep digital flexor's ulnar side. So flexor carpi ulnaris inserts on the pisiform bone. It's going to flex the wrist, but also ulnar deviate it. And the deep digital flexor's ulnar side will get to the fourth and fifth digits and curl the fingers at, flexing them at the distal interphalangeal joint. Now, when it gets to the hand, the ulnar nerve goes nuts. Its deep branch innervates the abductor digiti minimi. And if you've got a pulmonaris brevis that they're showing really pronounced in this illustration, it's innervating that too. But the hypothenar eminence, or the pad of the little finger here, pinky finger, is going to be having an abductor, a flexor digiti minimi brevis, and an opponens digiti minimi that helps pull it to
the midline. Those are all innervated by the ulnar nerve. The other muscle on the opposite side of the hand that innervates, that is innervated by the ulnar nerve, is the adductor pollicis that helps pull the thumb, the first digit, towards the rest of the hand. Now, those are all innervated by the deep branch of the ulnar, but the other muscles that are in between the metacarpals are these guys, the dorsal interossei, and very deep, not visible on this illustration, would be the palmar interossei. These are the ones that are very clinically relevant, because to test for an ulnar lesion, you're going to see if the person can open their fingers against resistance or close their fingers against resistance. And that's testing the interossei. The palmar interossei adduct, adduct the fingers, whereas the dorsal interossei abduct, abduct the digits right there. So you test the ulnar nerve's motor activity by having the person ab and adduct their fingers against resistance. So you can always remember, palmar, adduct, pad, dorsal, abduct, dab, pad, dab. Now, two other tiny muscles in the hand are innervated by the ulnar nerve's deep branch, and those are the third and fourth lumbricals. And those are the muscles that help flex at the metacarpal phalangeal joint, but actually are more involved in extending the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints up and over. All right, that's about it for the ulnar nerve. Now, testing the ulnar nerve's motor function in the forearm is sometimes not too useful, because despite the fact that it innervates these muscles on the ulnar side, there are many other flexors in the forearm that can mask weakness of the ulnar nerve. They're innervated by the median.
We've talked about everything that the lateral and medial cord contribute to the upper limb, more distally anyhow, these anterior divisions innervating structures of the anterior arm, and then the anterior forearm and hand. Now we're going to talk about the posterior cord's contributions to the upper limb, and that's going to be through the axillary nerve going to the shoulder region, and the radial nerve doing the posterior arm and forearm. So axillary nerve gets contributions from C5 and C6. So jumping back to C5 here, C5 root, superior trunk, but then these axons follow the posterior division of the superior trunk to reach the posterior cord. And from there, they jump off to form the axillary nerve, as do the C6 contributions to the superior trunk, passing posteriorly to the axillary artery, and then up to their buddy, the axillary nerve. All right, now we'll take a second and talk about the axillary nerve and the muscles and cutaneous regions that it innervates.
All right, now the axillary nerve is pretty simple. Its sensory innervation is just to a little patch on the lateral shoulder, and its motor innervation is to the deltoid muscle. Deltoid muscle has three bellies, an anterior belly that helps flex the arm at the shoulder, a posterior belly that helps extend the arm at the shoulder, and clinically the more important one, the third, the middle belly, helps abduct the arm at the shoulder. Now, one of the rotator cuff muscles initiates abduction, but it's the deltoid that maintains strong abduction past about the first 15 degrees or so. So to test that, you can have somebody abduct their arms against resistance, either with a weight, and hold it there, and just asymmetry, or just the inability to hold their arm up against resistance, is going to be a sign of axillary nerve involvement or deltoid weakness. Now, one other nerve innervated by the axillary is the teres minor, one of the rotator cuff muscles, and it's hanging out right here. Little guy that we'll discuss a little later with the rotator cuff. All right, that's it for the axillary nerve.
All right, that's all five except for the last branch, the radial nerve, and you'll notice it gets contributions from everybody, C5 down to T1, so let's follow those. The posterior cord already has C5 and C6 hanging out in it, so we'll just draw those in, running into the radial nerve, there, there, and then C7. Its posterior division joins the posterior cord, no big shocker there, to reach the radial nerve. C8's roots
join the inferior trunk, and here they jump on the posterior division of that trunk to join the posterior cord and contribute to radial nerve. And paralleling those exactly, we've got the T1 contributions. Inferior trunk to posterior cord to radial nerve. So here's our little radial rainbow there. I'll get the blue for C8 drawn in there as well. And let's take a second now and talk about our last big terminal branch, the radial nerve, and everything it does in the upper limb. Now the radial nerve is massive. It's going to be innervating pretty much every extensor of the arm, forearm, and the digits. So, in the arm, it's innervating the posterior compartment. The posterior compartment of the arm contains the triceps muscles, the long head, the lateral head, and the medial head. So right here, you've got the medial head, the long head is kind of hidden away right here, and then the lateral head coming down here and forming a strong tendon onto the olecranon process of the ulna. Any lesion of the radial nerve very, very proximally will result in an inability to extend the arm against resistance, or extend the forearm against resistance. So you can again have somebody attempt to work against a weight, and yeah, 15 pounds, and I'm not working too hard here, thankfully. Or starting here, and you can just push against their hands to see if there's weakness on one side, or if it's symmetric and the radial nerves are intact on both. In addition to the triceps muscles, we've also got the anconius, a little tiny muscle that assists the extension of the elbow. But one tricky thing about the triceps and the radial nerve is, if you've got a lesion of the radial nerve in the arm due to a humeral fracture, sometimes the triceps are relatively unaffected because they've had their motor branches already jump into the tricep before the nerve gets hit by the fracture. And in that case, you're going to be seeing radial nerve signs, not with the triceps, but with the extensors of the forearm. Now, in the forearm, the radial nerve innervates the brachioradialis, which we already discussed here, sometimes has dual innervation with the musculocutaneous, and it's going to innervate the long head of the extensor carpi radialis. So extensor carpi radialis has two heads, a long and a short, and they're going to extend the wrist and radially deviate the hand. Now, right around here, the radial nerve splits into a superficial branch that goes towards the skin and the hand, and a deep branch. The deep branch continues innervating muscles of the forearm. Now, the deep branch of the radial nerve innervates the short head of the extensor carpi radialis. It also innervates the supinator. The supinator is the kind of a counterpoint to the pronator teres. Pronator teres pronates the forearm. Supinator on the posterior side supinates the hand. If you need to keep those straight, think about the supinator does this, and you can drink your soup with your hand supinated. Kind of lame, but if that works for you, that's fine. Now that's about it for the deep branch of the radial nerve. It sends out an even deeper branch that's going to be called the posterior interosseous nerve. Now the posterior interosseous nerve innervates the rest of these extensors, and there's quite a few of them. We've got the extensor digitorum, the muscle that goes across the metacarpal phalangeal joints and strongly extends it. Now a lot of times people think it does this. What the MCP joint does is kind of let the digits fold up this way, and the extensor digitorum strongly extends it, but to extend proximal and distal interphalangeals, you actually need to have your lumbricals on the palmar side working. So the posterior interosseous innervates the extensor digitorum. It also innervates the extensor digiti minimi. It innervates the extensor indicus, and it innervates the extensor carpi ulnaris, which is going to extend the wrist, but also ulnar deviate. Now at that point, we jump to some muscles that are very deep, and we can see just a little bit of here. We've got the extensor digiti minimi that we discussed a minute ago. We've also got an extensor indicus that sends a single tendon out to the distal index finger, so the second digit, allows us to really strongly point with that digit, something we do a lot of. And it also has three muscles going to the thumb or the pollicis. You've got the abductor pollicis longus right here, the flexor pollicis brevis, and the flexor pollicis longus. So essentially abducting and extending the thumb. Sometimes a little difficult to get the difference between those. But abducting and extending the thumb is done by the posterior interosseous nerve, which is a branch of the radial. Now the superficial branch of the radial, way back up here, is sensory to the forearm and the hand, the radial side of the dorsum of the hand. And there were other small branches that came up in here that were sensory to the posterior arm. So loss of sensation on the arm, on its lateral or posterior side, and loss of sensation on the hand and dorsal or posterior side of the forearm are also signs of a radial nerve lesion. To check for a distal radial nerve lesion, you'd have the person try to extend their wrist against resistance. And the inability to do that symmetrically, if one side was weak, would be a sign that those forearm extensors have been compromised.
All right, now we've talked about the five major branches of the brachial plexus. Like I said, if you've got that down, you're probably going to be okay. But for completeness sake, let's talk about the branches off the cords. Now, the lateral cord has the lateral pectoral nerve, and that's going to be innervating part of the pectoralis major, and that's giving contributions, just like the musculocutaneous, from C5, 6, and 7. The medial pectoral nerve, and actually the medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm and the arm, all have the same profile. They're all getting contributions from C8 and T1. So these guys are all giving the same contributions as the ulnar nerve. Makes it relatively easy to keep track of what levels are involved there. Posterior cord gets a little more fun. Upper subscapular nerve comes from C5. Lower subscapular nerve comes from C6. And then thoracodorsal is a fun one. It's getting contributions from 5, 6, and 7. All right, so now we'll take a little break and talk about the muscles that are innervated and the regions of the body that are innervated by the cords. The lateral pectoral nerve coming off the lateral cord, medial pectoral nerve, and then the cutaneous nerves of the arm and forearm off the medial cord, and then the upper and lower subscapulars, and the thoracodorsal. So the muscles of the cords are going to be coming off the lateral, medial, and posterior cord. The medial cord gives off the medial pectoral nerve, which is going to be innervating the pectoralis major and the pectoralis minor, which is a little bit hidden in this illustration, but it's traveling up deep to the pectoralis major to reach the coracoid process of the scapula. The lateral cord gives off the lateral pectoral nerve, which innervates the pectoralis major as well, primarily the clavicular head. And pectoralis major is involved in strongly flexing the shoulder from an extended position. So doing push-ups or a bench press, that's what people are trying to do with those exercises, is develop their pectoral muscles. And an inability to push symmetrically could be tied to nerve damage or rupture of the muscle. Pectoralis minor helps to stabilize the scapula and kind of pull it over, so kind of turtling the shoulder is pectoralis minor. And actually, if anybody has been to the gym and spotted those guys who skip leg workout and they never work their back, but they're only doing bench press, and they're getting well-developed pectorals but weak back muscles, they'll sometimes have kind of a hunched appearance because that pectoralis minor is overpowering the back muscles and they're not getting their shoulders kind of neutrally located there. Fun little fact there. Go ahead and check out the gym, see if you can spot it. Now, the medial cord also has two sensory branches, the medial cutaneous nerve of the arm and the medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm, and their names
are exactly what you'd expect. From T1 and C8, you're getting innervation of the medial arm, medial form, and lesion of the medial cord. Might weaken the pectoralis major, but you might actually have an easier time spotting it with that sensory loss here, which, by the way, would also involve the ulnar nerve, since it's entirely from the medial cord. Pectoral lesions are sometimes hard to spot because the pectoralis muscles are not the only things that flex the arm at the shoulder. You've got the deltoids anterior belly, you've got the coracobrachialis, so weakness may be a little bit masked, but that sensory loss will be something people note, or at least you'll be able to find through fine touch sensing or pain sensing. Now moving on to the posterior cord, we've got three nerves coming off of it, the upper and lower subscapular and thoracodorsal. Let's start with the thoracodorsal because it's a little confusing, not in how it innervates muscles, but in how you test it. The muscles it innervates are the latissimus dorsi, this long, broad muscle of the back, and the teres major. And both of these actually insert at the same place on the medial humerus and wrap all the way around. Now standing here, if I were to contract my latissimus dorsi, this is about what you'd see. A little bit of adduction of the arms. But you would test the latissimus dorsi by seeing if it can strongly adduct from an already abducted position. So flexing the shoulders, or abducting them here, pulling them down, or extending them from an already flexed position, like rowing, is going to be testing to see how latissimus dorsi works. So if you want to see if that muscle is working well, you see if you have symmetrical rowing motion or symmetrical pull-up motion that way. Now the upper and lower subscapular nerves innervate the subscapularis muscle. Ain't that nice? Subscapularis muscle is very deep. It's on the anterior surface of the scapula. It's not really visible in this illustration. And it's going to be one of the rotator cuff muscles. These muscles primarily hold the head of the humerus tight in the glenoid fossa of the scapula. So they keep our humeral head from dislocating very easily. But they also have individual actions. And the subscapularis muscle is going to internally rotate the arm. So if I'm trying to internally rotate the arm, that's testing the subscapularis. And inability to do that, or a persistently externally rotated arm, may be a sign that you've got a subscapular or a posterior cord lesion. Now we'll cover the rest of the rotator cuff muscles as we talk about the trunks and the roots.
All right, we're done with the cords. Let's march backward a little bit now and talk about the divisions, trunks, and roots. This is actually pretty easy. Dorsal scapular nerve is innervated by C5. And we might occasionally get a little bit of C4 jumping in there as well. We'll just draw that in dashed right here. And suprascapular nerve gets its contributions from C5 and C6. And maybe just a little bit of C4 from way up here jumping on there as well, but we won't worry too much about that. And the nerve to the subclavius muscle, despite it being pretty scrawny, actually gets contributions from two different levels, C5 and C6. And that takes care of all the nerves coming off, the roots and the trunks, except for this one weird guy hanging out here, the long thoracic nerve. Long thoracic nerve, pretty easy to see, has contributions from C5, C6, and C7. All right, now let's take a second and talk about these nerves and the things that they innervate. The dorsal scapular, suprascapular nerve, nerve of the subclavius, and the long thoracic nerve.
All right, now the superior trunk gives off several branches. One of them is the nerve to the subclavius, and the subclavius is a muscle you can't see here, but it's located underneath the clavicle, and it helps stabilize the clavicle or maybe flex the shoulder ever so slightly that way. But the subclavius muscle isn't tremendously functional, and you're never going to find a way to test it very easily. It helps keep the clavicle from distracting much if you have a clavicular fracture. So it's important, but you're not going to test it too easily, and you might not even notice that it's lesioned were that nerve to be cut in isolation. However, off the superior trunk, we've got another nerve that definitely gets a lot of activity and a lot of clinical testing. That's the suprascapular nerve. And it's going to be innervating other muscles of the rotator cuff. And the other muscles of the rotator cuff are located right under here. You can see right here, this is the infraspinatus, and deep to here, we'd have the supraspinatus. Now the infraspinatus and the accompanying teres minor, which is innervated by the axillary nerve, are rotator cuff muscles that are on the posterior side of the rotator cuff. So they're going to be the counterpoint to the subscapularis. Subscapularis internally rotates the arm at the shoulder, but the infraspinatus and teres minor externally rotate it. And the lesion of the superior trunk, one characteristic thing that will happen is you'll have a persistently internally rotated arm, and it won't externally rotate even if you ask the person to do so. The other muscle that's innervated by the suprascapular nerve is the supraspinatus. Now that muscle, we talked about briefly before, helps initiate abduction. So it gets the arm started abducting, and then the deltoid takes over to get us to about horizontal. So the inability to initiate that abduction may be a sign of a supraspinatus lesion or a suprascapular nerve lesion. People may sometimes be unaware of this because they'll sway to get that motion started and then the deltoid will pick it up. So to test it, you have them stand straight, you can press their arms to their side and see if they can initiate abduction or not. The other muscle that's innervated by something very proximal, muscle group I should say, is going to be the muscles innervated by the dorsal scapular nerve, which comes off the C5 root. These muscles are all very deep to the trapezius here. And they include the rhomboids. We see a little bit of rhomboid major right here, going from the spinous processes to the medial border of the scapula, teres major, and just superior to it, teres minor, and off the superior angle of the scapula, going to the cervical vertebra, we have levator scapulae. Dorsal scapular nerve innervates all of those, and they're going to be a little tough to spot lesions of those because they help pull the scapulae together on the side. So they're going to retract the scapulae. So basically, if the back is here, they're going to pull everything together that way. Problem is, they're not the only muscle that does that. The big trapezius muscle that's superficial to it also has that same motion through its middle fibers and can mask lesion of the dorsal scapular nerve in that regard. The levator scapulae muscles help elevate the scapula, but guess what? So is the trapezius's superior fibers. So dorsal scapular nerve lesions, not something that's very easy to find unless you're doing an electromyographic analysis of the person's muscle to see if there's specific denervation.
So we have covered the muscles and the areas of skin that are innervated by the nerves of the brachial plexus. Let's talk lesions. Now we already spoke a little bit about the lesions associated with the musculoskeletal, musculocutaneous, axillary, median, radial, and ulnar nerves. Now let's talk about the cords and the trunks. Now, this can be very simple, or we can make it incredibly complicated. Because I'm just that kind of person, let's make it simple. So, if we wind up with damage to the cords or the trunks, they're pretty much going to have characteristics that involve all the things downstream. So, musculocutaneous nerve, we already talked about. Weakness in flexing the arm at the elbow, flexing the forearm at the elbow, and loss of sensation along the lateral aspect of the forearm. If the lateral cord is damaged, we'd see musculocutaneous signs, but we'd also see median nerve signs, particularly the C6 and C7 contributions. So those would be fairly proximal muscles of the median nerve, so things like the forearm flexors, the pronator teres. So if we were to see or have damage to the lateral cord, first off, we'd probably have damage to the axillary artery, which would be bad. But anytime you see combination of musculocutaneous and median nerve signs, you can place that lesion somewhere along the lateral cord. And if that occurs fairly proximally, you're also going to have some weakness, although not complete, of
the pectoralis major due to involvement of the lateral pectoral nerve. Likewise, if we have damage to the medial cord somewhere along its length, we're definitely going to have problems with the ulnar nerve. Now, what's that going to involve? That's going to involve wasting, atrophy, and weakness of the intrinsic muscles of the hand, except for the pad of the thumb, which, as we talked about, is from the median nerve's recurrent branch. The ulnar nerve will also have weakness, although not complete paralysis, of the ability to flex the wrist, because the flexor carpi ulnaris will be weak, as well as the ulnar side of the flexor carpi, the flexor digitorum profundus. So, we have the ulnar nerve signs in addition to median nerve signs more distally. So if we have complete atrophy of the hand muscles, including the pad of the thumb, first two lumbricals, and weakness of the forearm flexors of the median, that's a pretty good sign that we've got a lesion somewhere in the medial cord. And if we throw in loss of sensation or altered sensation of the medial forearm, or the medial forearm and the medial arm, and maybe even pectoralis major and pectoralis minor weakness, that's pretty much something we can throw at the medial cord. So medial cord will definitely involve median and ulnar nerve signs, and may involve the cutaneous nerve of the forearm, cutaneous nerve of the arm, and the medial pectoral nerve. Now, last up is the posterior cord. No big shocker here. Any posterior cord lesion has to affect what's downstream, axillary nerve and radial nerve. So in this case, we'd have weakness of the deltoid muscle and an inability or extreme weakness flexing, abducting, and extending the shoulder. Radial nerve would mean that we've got paralysis or weakness in extending the forearm at the elbow, extending the wrist or the hand, and extending the digits. So if you see those signs together, you can pretty confidently put that problem at the posterior cord. And if you wind up with subscapular nerve weakness, that's going to be an inability to inwardly rotate the arm, so the arm would be persistently externally rotated, and weakness of the thoracodorsal nerve, latissimus dorsi. Those constellation of signs mean that you've got damage to the posterior cord somewhere along its course. All right. That's the cords. Trunks. Now, this could be ridiculous because the superior trunk, as you can see, contributes to anything that's got a little bit of red in it. Middle trunk, anything with a little green in it. And the inferior trunk, anything with a little bit of blue and purple in it. So this could be potentially very confusing. Here's the good news. Damage to the superior trunk and the C5 or C6 roots tends to happen when someone falls and their head hits the ground and their shoulder hits the ground and it pushes their head and shoulder apart. That's going to put traction on these nerves and it's going to tend to tear the superior trunk or the C5 and C6 roots. When that happens, you're going to wind up with constellation of signs that may involve the dorsal scapular, suprascapular, and anything that gets its input from the superior trunk. This is known as Herb Duchenne palsy.
Herb Duchenne palsy affects things that are innervated by C5 and C6, and that's going to be involving the axillary nerve, the suprascapular nerve, the musculocutaneous nerve, and the lateral pectoral nerve. Clinically, they manifest mostly in terms of having somebody who's got a persistently internally rotated arm at the shoulder and an elbow that will not flex, at least not strongly, against any resistance. So you have an internally rotated arm at the shoulder because you've lost your suprascapular nerve. So infraspinatus is no longer able to assist in external rotation, nor is teres minor because of the axillary nerve being knocked out. On top of that, supraspinatus and deltoid are going to be deprived of their innervation as well. So abducting the arm won't be possible. So persistently adducted, internally rotated, and extended elbow, because musculocutaneous nerve will be severely affected as well. Those are the hallmarks of Herb Duchenne palsy, often caused by head being pushed to the side either in a fall or during a breech delivery if the head is pushed away.
Now, middle trunk lesions in green are very rare because you have to go through the superior trunk to get to it if you have someone's shoulder being pushed away from their head, and that level of trauma is going to be pretty darn awful and involve a lot of other things. So middle trunk lesions are not traditionally something we spend a lot of time studying. However, inferior trunk lesions do tend to happen when the arm is forcefully abducted away from the body, such as your arm gets pulled way over your head against resistance. That sometimes happens if someone puts too much traction on a child's arm during delivery, or if someone's falling and they reach out and grab something and it yanks their arm up. It can actually tear C8 and T1 roots or the inferior trunk. This is actually fairly simple because it's going to affect things that get their C8 and T1 innervation. So the ulnar nerve, all of these guys from the medial cortical definitely involved, as well as radial and medial or median nerve signs. So how does this present? Lupke's paralysis is a nice counterpoint to Herb Duchenne palsy. Herb Duchenne palsy hit C5 and 6. The Klumpke's paralysis or Klumpke's palsy happens when the arm is forcibly abducted away, tearing the C8 and T1 roots or the inferior trunk, and it's going to affect anything that has C8 and T1 innervation. It's going to appear pretty much the same as a medial cord lesion because your ulnar nerve, your medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm, medial cutaneous nerve of the arm are all going to be affected. The additional losses that will be seen will be the medial pectoral nerve will definitely be involved, so a little weakness pectoral-wise, but distal, radial, and median innervation will also be compromised, so weakness extending the wrist and flexing the wrist and muscles of the hand will all be seen in the Klumpke's paralysis.
Okay, so we've talked about damage to the trunks, superior trunk, Herb Duchenne palsy, inferior trunk, Klumpke's palsy or Klumpke paralysis, and last, we've got this very proximal nerve, the long thoracic nerve. It's actually very, very close to the body wall, so it tends to get damaged in trauma that involves the thoracic wall, or sometimes it can be damaged during mastectomies or removal of the lymph nodes of the armpit because it's so very close to the body there. The long thoracic nerve, as we discussed, innervates the serratus anterior muscle, which helps protract the scapula. Now, what that means to us in general is that the scapula, when this nerve is functional, can be held close to the body wall. So if you do a push-up, your scapula don't stick up out of your back. They're held tight to the body wall because that muscle is functional. Loss of this results in a winged scapula, or a scapula that is unable to stay stuck to the body wall and will actually push outward. What the serratus anterior does is it's attaching to the ribs and runs across the thoracic wall to the medial border of the scapula, so very deep to right here, and it keeps the scapula on the body wall. So if it's not working, you'd commonly get what's referred to as a winged scapula. So you test it by having a person do a push-up if they're able, or lean against a wall. And if their lateral thoracic artery was depriving that muscle of blood, or the long thoracic nerve was deinnervated, the scapula wouldn't stick to the body wall in a nice, solid way so that the arms can move the body. It would wing out, and I can't really demo that nicely, but you'd know it if you saw it. The scapula would literally push out the skin on the back because it would not be being held to the body wall that way. Fun fact, this is sometimes referred to as the boxer's muscle because boxers have to have that muscle active when they make contact. Otherwise, every time they hit, their scapula would boing, push back out the side, and that's no good in the ring. All right, that's it for muscles and nerves of the brachial plexus. I hope this has been helpful.